like to call the Finance Committee to order. Do we have any other groups that need to be called to order right now?
I'd like to call the School Committee to order.
We're still waiting.
Very good.
Thank you for joining us for the Financial Forum this evening. Tonight's meeting is being recorded live for RCT. It's available on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33. The videographer for tonight's meeting is Kevin Bent. All right, so this evening, we kind of have review and then preview, and then potentially revote. So let's start with the review. Sharon, can you move this?
I'm going to start on page two of your packet. And it's the certification coming from MassDOR for our free cash. And you'll notice that our free cash last year was about $800,000. We're up a little over $200,000 from where we were last year, despite all of our free cash use. If you remember, we used about $2.8 million for free cash, and that would have been $4 million if we had left the modulators. So it would have gone down if we had left the modulators as free cash. Down to $1 million. So that may be a good choice on our part to keep our free cash high, to borrow for that. And then you can see the water, sewer, and stormwater reserves, which are very strong. And Bob made a notation yet that they're planning to use $1 million of the sewer reserves for capital. On page three, you see calculation that comes straight off of my calculation of cash, and it's pretty much the regeneration page. And we look at that section, you can see that revenues, you see a column for budget and actual, and you can see the difference. Essentially, we had revenues coming in $1.6 million over budget. The primary contributors were property tax, excise tax, and charges for services and other.
What was other?
Other is insurance dividends, refunds of prior year expenses, health insurance from other communities, and sale of an asset. So those are the things that we wouldn't be able to budget sale cash that was going to happen. So those sorts of things we struggle with because excise tax is one of those where it's a declining tax. The longer you own your car, the less you pay. And ours has been on the rise for the last 3 years. You think it would peak and come back down, but it hasn't yet. We keep seeing extra money. And so it's hard to budget that number appropriately because you could have a revenue deficit if you budget too optimistically. And so we struggle with that because we still, you know, we increase it every year based on our actual and we come up higher. So, which is very fortunate for us, but it's not overly conservatively budgeted yet. It's still over. So, and on the bottom, you can see the expenses are under by 1.4 million or just under 1.5. And then we have prior year money that was brought forward and that was turned back of 140,000. So we're under budget by 1.6 on the expense side. The primary contributors to that were unfilled positions on the town side, about $355,000. $200,000 or a little more than $200,000 for special ed district placements that didn't come to fruition. $341,000 for unused capital. The biggest piece of that is $200,000 for Killam Field improvements that came in over, the bids came in over budget, so we weren't able to proceed with the project. And another piece of that was $50,000 for a town hall generator that when we went to do it, it ended up being a lot more than $50,000, so we could not do the project. So that happens, it seems, every year, a little bit of unused capital for varying reasons. Sometimes it's coming in over budget, sometimes we just don't have the time to do all the capital that's planned. And I think it makes us really kind of think about our capital plan, like how much of it's projects and how much it's purchasing an actual asset where we'd actually use the funds. Because when you have too many projects, I feel like we sometimes fail to get to something. So that's something I see on the right. On page four, you get a look, four and five, actually, more synopsis of regeneration for the history of 2010 to 2015. I'm not going to go over it in too much detail, but you can see how regeneration has started to grow over time. I mean, we're starting to see really high numbers in regeneration. And despite our efforts to be less conservative in our budgeting style, for varying reasons, and every year it's something different. So below, you see property taxes, and I'll, you know, give reasons why I think that might have happened. So if you read through that, you might get some explanations. But what I'm thinking of doing for our next meeting is potentially showing something of a more simplified table so that we can maybe that information, but I certainly want to give it to you in an easier to digest format. But this is information that you can kind of look at and see over the years, where has the free cash been coming from? What are the sources? On page 6, it's just a chart that shows the growth of free cash from 1995 to 2018 projected out. And I use less conservative estimates. We've always used 750,000 as our regeneration, and then we put in what we think we might use for free cash. I used for 2017 and 18, $2 million of free cash and $1.5 million of regeneration. But you can see that over time, we have been on the upswing for quite a while. And so just to show you that we've had really, you know, lean years with free cash, and then all of a sudden we start to grow it. And I think it is our conservative budgeting style that does that. And DOR doesn't frown upon it. They actually encourage us to be a little bit conservative. They don't want you to have to cut your budget to mid-year. So you can't be overly optimistic. They're going to question if you put it through on your free cash that way. You know, why are you projecting 10% over what you did last year? They will actually question it. So I think our budgeting style does seem to regenerate a lot of cash, but I don't think we're overly conservative, so it's puzzling how much we regenerate. And the final page here on page 7 that I'm going to review with you is kind of small, actually. But again, it's basically what that chart that you just saw is based off of, and it shows you what the free cash was at the beginning of each year, what the regeneration was, the net regeneration, and then our uses of free cash since the free cash had been certified, and then your ending free cash. And down the bottom, it's a summary. And again, it's just kind of for informational purposes so that you can see how much free cash we use every year, how much our regeneration tends to be. And if you look in recent years, it's been over, you know, averaging over $2 million. In some cases, over $3 million of regeneration. So it is kind of puzzling because every year we look at it and say the sources are always different, but there's always so much. And so I figured this was something we've looked at in the past that you might want to see just to get yourself some idea of where, how much are we using and how much are we spending, you know, how much regeneration is coming through on the average. Anybody have any more questions about cash?
Go back to page 4 just for a second. Yeah. I'm looking at a line called charges for services.
Yes.
$200,000, that's very favorable.
On page 4?
Page 4, yep. Charges for services is 22.
It's favorable for 213,000.
Column November town meeting changes an extra $412,000 of property taxes, had shown that as 200,000 on their over. New growth was certified last week, 912,000, so that's an extra 212,000, which is even higher than I would have hoped for, actually. And that, to some degree, is linked to those building permits. We all know what's going on downtown. People are paving the roads and knocking down houses. It's hard to get there. 100,000 under transfers we discussed as part of the facilities change. It's coming out of one of the walls punishment schools. So if you will, there's 500,000 of what I call sustainable revenues. That's changed from last spring, which is good. We're also using almost 700,000 of free cash, which I'll circle back to. Most or all of that is being spent on one-time capital, which is a good thing to do. 688,000. That figure is 200,000 higher than you would have seen before, and I have some backup in the packet that I'll go over later with FinCom. The Permanent Building Committee has met 3 or 4 times, and at their meeting last week, they requested at town meeting that we fund $200,000 to do a design through construction documents work on the cemetery garage. So that's why 200,000 more of capital is shown, and that's why, if you will, that 200,000 is pretty much fully using up the new growth that appeared since we were at Coolidge. And again, you have a nice match where there's $500,000 of recurring costs near the bottom there, and it's a nice match with the recurring revenues and the one-time expenses match the one-time free cash. So that's just a snapshot of what November town meeting looks like. Excuse me. If you turn your attention to FY17 and then we can start on page 9, I'm going to do this 2 different ways. I'll first just really focus on FY17, making a couple of assumptions which are important ones. Sharon has upped her ante from 750,000 to maybe as high as 1.5 million for regeneration. So we're certainly in a position to talk about using $2 million to balance the budget if that's accurate, and it's probably not too far off. It might be a little less conservative than we are usually. If we do use $2 million for free cash, and both the schools and the town have combed through all the accommodated costs as best we can, we've looked at the debt service and filled in capital and so forth. We have made an assumption for health insurance of 8%, and we have, we will have a discussion with FinCom. We can have that tonight as to whether FinCom is willing to plug any higher increase in the free cash as we did last year. I know from my perspective, I know John will agree that having some kind of budget certainty before January or February when you learn these things is really helpful. And then another big assumption is 2.5% state aid. I don't think anyone really knows what that's going to look like. But again, if that's something that FinCom would put some free cash behind for the same reason, it would be very helpful. That one we may not even know till June. We just can't tell.
When will we know our health costs?
Third week of February. Okay. And I had a meeting with them a couple weeks ago, and we'd be lucky to get 8%, is the unfortunate news. National health insurance premiums are trending closer to 10, and then prescription drugs, believe it or not, are 25%. So we're about 1/4 prescription drugs and 3/4 the other. So if we're average, we're looking at 12 or 14%. I don't think we'll be that bad. We actually had a pretty good year experience-wise for health. But it's obviously a pretty significant problem. So again, with all those assumptions, including some of the important ones I've hit, we're looking at a 3.25% operating budget, which is better than the current year, but you can see to the left on the top of that page, not quite as good as 3 years prior, where we were between 3.5 and 3.75. And I will also add that this isn't a bad number to come in October, but then it usually gets better. Both the schools and the town worked extra hard this year to get that better now, because we know it's going to be a difficult budget discussion for the next couple of years. So I would not necessarily have as much expectation that number will drift higher in the next month or two. We may hear some news that's good, but the 3.25, maybe 3.5 is probably where we'll be. And I'll leave the future for the next couple of pages. Is there any questions on just that comment on 17? If you turn to pages 10 and 11, and these are new pages that were not in the packet that somebody got over the weekend. I had a couple of discussions this week, and folks thought that some of this information would be helpful. If you recall, both what the superintendent and I described in our budget reports to town meeting last April, the 2.75% in the current year is not adequate for what our constituents want. We each cited $1 million shortfall in our budgets based on what we thought were demanded. And we both also said that does not include several things that we could put in budgets that have been requested, but are just obviously so not affordable we didn't even bother. So if you look at that third paragraph, I guess that one's okay. If you look at the next one, the FY18 to FY20, this is where it really kind of gets a little more descriptive. That chart on the bottom is just a simple chart of, you know, what if 3.5% operating budgets were satisfactory? I'm not sure they are, but if we were perhaps at a different baseline, then 3.5% a year might be okay if health insurance behaved. But look at, the 3.5 is the top line. That's what we'd like. What we're faced with is the line below, where we're looking at 3% revenues, which is pretty reasonable given Prop 2.5. It's only going to get higher, either with new growth or with more taxes, really. And then 5% accommodated costs historically are pretty good. We've done a really nice job over the last few years, even getting that closer to zero. But unless you cut capital, I don't see any zeros in the future. Between energy and health insurance, it's just not going to happen. So there's the gap. There's the problem. That's the structural deficit under Prop 2.5. If our accommodated costs would behave at Prop 2.5, we'd be fine, but they don't. You know, if state aid and health insurance, you could peg at 2.5% every year, we'd all feel much better, especially health insurance. That'd be great. So that's kind of the backdrop of something we talk about every year, and I just thought it'd be interesting to see in the picture. And that works out to be about $1 million a year in our budgets. Every year, another $1 million we have to cut in order to just balance. For FY18 and 20, when I looked ahead, rather than do what we've done for the last couple of years, I return to what I would call financial best practices. That, for instance, trims the use of free cash down to $1.5 million, which is what Sharon is saying, sustainable, instead of two. We do that gradually over the 3 years. We really should be increasing our contributions to OPEB and snow and ice. That's a much better practice. As it is, in OPEB, we're not even meeting 25% of the annual obligation, so increasing it by $50,000 or $100,000 a year, and I only did 50, is not that big of a deal. We've, for 2 years, including 17, suggested to divert capital into the operating budgets, which I've agreed with, but the best practice is not to do that. And FinCom in the last year has discussed increasing their reserves. And I remember when I was on FinCom almost 20 years ago, it was $150,000. So I know it's been there at least 20 years. $150,000 doesn't go quite as far as it used to 20 years ago. So those are the important assumptions, and the net result is operating budgets of less than 1%. Obviously, these assumptions aren't necessarily going to be what happens, but there is neutral an assumption and a best practice conservative finance as assumption as is possible. And what it's telling you is, you just can't get to 3.5% unless you continue to find bags of tricks and cut some corners here and there. And again, financially with our free cash, we're in a pretty good position to cut those corners, but it's generally not a good idea. If you're trying to build sustainable budgets, this is not the way to do it. On what is page 11, I discussed this a little. You know, the unmet needs are about $2 million. There's a desire for more. Who knows what that's worth? And then there's $1 million structural deficit every year. You add all that up, and the selectmen discussed this quite openly at their last meeting, the background for an operational override is clear. The last operational override the town had was 13 years ago with a forecast that it would be needed in another 8 to 10 years. We've made a lot of changes over those 13 years, especially in financial practices. The Finance Committee knows about it. They've been key in many of those. But the fact of the matter is, when health insurance is going to go up 10% or 12%, there's not much you can do internally to become more efficient to curb that increase. If it's going to happen, you just can't. It's important to keep in mind as we discuss the concept of an override. Reading voters have two debt exclusions out there. Through FY24, there's $1.3 million a year for the high school and a couple of smaller amounts for other school projects. And about $1.5 million through 1 year longer for the library. So if you want to take your long-term view, 10 years from now, both those debt exclusions are paid off. The climate could be right again for another override, only from a relief of $3 million a year to the taxpayer standpoint, if you will. And one other thing that's certainly worth mentioning, the Board of Selectmen for almost 2 years have been meeting in executive session, including with some other boards, on some long-term, pretty significant real estate projects. If any of these work out, the soonest revenue comes in from any of them that I can see is 5 years, and it's more likely to be 7 to 10. But these projects, we'd like to have a solution for today, but if we can work on some of this, that may obviate the need for the override in another 8 to 10 years. It's quite possible that that revenue can step in. But we have no such revenue over the next couple of years that we can pull out of the hat. It's just not there. On page 12, there's just a little bit of summary of what I've told you. You can see the circles declining use of free cash over the 3 years going forward. And up top, you can see the less than 1% operating budgets, which is really the structural deficit we're looking at. I can pretty much guarantee you that we wouldn't have a 1% operating budget because we will have other tools. But this is if you didn't have any tools at all and you just looked at it neutrally. So that's really the background of that. I do want to just quickly get to another couple of pages, but let FinCom and others know. On page 14, this draft minutes of the Permanent Building Committee, where the request for $200,000 was made. And Mr. Brown of the Cemetery Trustees suggested he would move to indefinitely postpone Article 13, which is the request for $2 million. So if FinCom is willing and if the selectmen are interested to vote on that tonight, later you can. On page 16, you'll see the changes in Article 3. It's an addition of $200,000, and it's a subtraction of a $2 million debt finance project. And then on page 18, actually page 19, there's the additional $200,000 of capital requested. And on page 20, there's the additional new growth that more than pays for it at the bottom of page 20.
Bob, what was the additional amount in Article 4? There was one other bill.
That's a good point. Yeah. We found in the last week an additional $50 of the last year's bill. I didn't bring anything with me, so
I remember 50.
FinCom can vote on that if they trust Sharon and I.
It's an employee reimbursement
form. An employee was getting a Class A driver's license, and there's $250 expenses.
We'll report it then.
So
once the permit,
he did the first one in April, and he just did the second one and thought, all right, I'll ask for my $100. It's like, wait a minute, that's 2 fiscal years.
Yeah.
What's a fiscal year?
So technically, you're not supposed to pay that in the
Bob, just to roll you backwards for 1 second.
Yeah.
On the on page 12, where you're looking at the outlook 18, 19, 20, even though these numbers are operating budgets of plus anything, the reality is that we're talking about service cuts, right?
Well, absolutely.
Matt,
I'm sure John would say the same.
So that's what would be required if we need to keep it in that range.
Yeah, I'll speak for myself and say a 3% budget some years causes a service cut. Depends on luck in some ways. You pretty much need more than 3% not to have a reduction. I don't know, John, if you're similar. Any other questions on? Yeah, Barry.
So Bob, those of us who have been looking at these budgets for a long time understand that there is built in a structural deficit, that at some point, if you do not hit the reset button, your ability to pay for the services that you want become diminished. How do we, and we've known this, we've looked at this, we understand this, but for the average citizen out there, how do we sort of true up these two factors? One is that we have the structural operating budget. At the same time, our free cash has really grown a lot. Now, both are true. And so how do we, as leaders in the community, talk about that in a way that, you know, makes sense so people can understand that if they want to still have the services that they desire, it's still okay and beneficial to have money in the bank and ask for more. That is how I'm trying to get my head around it. And I know kind of the questions that I think you're going to get.
Yeah, so. I know the perception out there, and I know how we all sort of view it. We were a corporation, we declare a cash dividend one time. So I'm going to figure out a way to do that. We'll talk to our assessor. You know, the problem has nothing to do with the amount of free cash there is, and that's the message you somehow have to convey. Now, the problem can be solved with that free cash for one or two more years, then you have to ask a voter, and that's the other part of the message. If you really want to wait until we're down to 50,000 or 200,000 like we had this many years ago, all right, let's do that. Let's start using $5 million a year to balance the budget, and let's see how fast that happens. So I don't think anyone here thinks that's a good practice, but you don't want to threaten things you won't do, but that would answer the question. You know, you have a structural deficit running your house. You want to run your bank account, your rainy day account to zero before you recognize it? Some people do. It's not the best practice, though. It's definitely an optics thing that has to be addressed, though. What other communities do, which is interesting, and I think I've said this before, but not much. Other communities have lots of places to tuck free cash. They have capitalization stabilization funds. I was at a breakfast this morning where a very well-known community was bragging about their $3.2 million in free cash. I was appalled. Then I remembered he's got $10 million tucked away in a stabilization fund. So we don't do that. If we did, our free cash would look different. Same. What's the difference whether it's called stabilization or free cash? It's really not that different other than two-thirds vote.
Right. Yeah.
And do you really want to start playing those games with the taxpayers in Reading? I mean, if there's a reason to have a stabilization fund that's not political, then let's do it. But that's a simple fact that that's why other towns have an easier time. They don't like showing free cash, a lot of it, for this reason. On the other hand, Wilmington has $10 or $12 million of free cash. So, go figure. On the revenue side, let's look at page 21, because this might help frame the kind of issue. Before I explain what the page says, just take a look at those communities. And I'll answer for the town side. And nothing against any of our neighbors or anyone on the list, but the services that are requested of us at Reading town government most often approximate the four communities or five communities at the top of the list. Those are the communities with the highest property tax bills. So Lexington, Winchester, and Andover are the most common names we hear, especially at Town Hall, and some degree Winfield. Look at the average tax bill that those folks pay. It's not quite double what Reading is, but it's substantially higher. So Reading is just below 7,000 in the current fiscal year. You know, some of these communities we're compared against are $3,000 to $5,000 a year higher. So from a service perspective, what the schools in the town are asked to deliver is quite different than what the optics of the town suggest it can afford. Obviously, we can't deliver what we're being requested, but this is why. I can't tell you how many times in the last 6 months I've had this discussion, but in Winchester, they do it this way. Well, if you'd pay another $3,000 to $4,000 a year, we could too. Oh, you're kidding me. It's nowhere near like that. Oh, yeah, it is.
Okay.
So one of them had to do with
water. Your mortgage would be higher.
Yeah, exactly. One of them had to do with, surely DPW can go out and water the plants downtown every couple of days. I was like, no, they can't. We don't have enough. We don't have extra staff sitting around. Well, they do in Winchester. Okay. Hope they're not watching. So I think my first point on this chart is just really consider that list. And when I describe some of the other things, you know, what does Reading really want to be? What do the folks that live here want to be? What do you want to be? If you look to the left, that chart, excluding the Reading 16, which is a projection, that's all current 2015 tax data. That's the average single-family tax bill on the left-hand margin and the average single-family home down below. And you can see a regression line plotted there. So that's DOR data, so it's pretty clean data. We use the pay and class study peer communities, which was the Finance Committee list plus a couple others from our recent study. But in talking to our assessors, I excluded Burlington, Danvers, Wilmington, and Westboro, because combined, those four have a 30% commercial tax base, and Reading is less than 10. Reading is the lowest on this list of resident of commercial tax base. We were talking to someone yesterday from Burlington, and although I've seen this data, I never thought of it in this way. He said that the commercial tax base in Burlington pays 75% of the property taxes.
Right.
And that's because they're 30-something percent with a 1.75 factor. And you don't see businesses not going to Burlington. So, you know, that's staggering when you think a community can have 3/4 of its property tax from businesses. You know, Reading's not going to do that.
You said that
in
Burlington?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's worth repeating. That's on the list.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. So that's the reason that we excluded four of these communities, just because of the commercial tax base. I don't think it'd make it comparable for this discussion. And the big assumption here, which is as good as any I could think of, is the value of your house approximates the services that the town and the schools deliver. Now, we know the value of a house has other factors, but John and I like to think this is the reason. Proximity to Boston and the train station might have something to do with it. And when you look at, again, today's data, Reading is actually a couple or $300 below the trend line for property tax. So, you know, especially at Town Hall, I don't know if the schools get this quite as much. There's a constant discussion about, I pay too many taxes in Reading. Well, maybe you do, but you pay less than all these average communities on a trend line, you know, for the value of your house. You know, too much, too little is subjective, but the point is mathematically the tax bill in Reading is not high. Some of these communities like North Reading have more excluded debt for their high school than we do, for sure, and that's why North Reading is above that line, just about where we are. If you then roll forward, and the selectmen are having a tax classification hearing next Tuesday, if they do not split the rate, the average Reading home, and again, this is as of last December, so it doesn't include the market from this spring and summer, went up almost 8% in assessed value for a single family home. And tax bills went up 6% because the library debt exclusion is finally hitting a lot more.
Whereas business only 1.6%.
Businesses are up 1% for assessed value.
And 1.6 on taxes
for taxes. So we don't know what the other communities will look like, but I think it's reasonable to think that Reading will remain slightly below the trend line. And again, remember the trend line is not a trend of desired services. The desired services are way up in the right-hand corner of that trend line quite often. You know, look at the top four communities or maybe around the 600,000 homes. You know, people pay in between 8,000 and 9,000 a year, or in some cases higher, are the service levels I think we're generally being asked to deliver. But it's certainly important, and Dan made this really clear at the selectmen's meeting, not only are there people in this community that don't want to pay more, they can't. So we have to be really sensitive to the fact that, you know, we have elderly, especially in the town, and it's certainly a mission statement of the selectmen and our planners to try to house them and keep them here. So it's a very fine line. We have some very well-to-do people that have moved to town. Their houses have certainly gone up a lot in value. By all external measures, they could afford an override, but there's people that can't. And that's, you know, that's the discussion the selectmen and others are going to have over the next year or so. So I thought this chart would be a pretty simple way to just kind of get that discussion started. It's not exactly accurate because it doesn't measure services. If there were a measure of services, I'm very confident that Reading would look better on a relative basis than our money would suggest. Anecdotally, we hear that all the time about especially human elder services. In our library, we deliver a lot more than most communities with similar tax bills do. And I'm sure John hears similar things.
Bob, do you have any thoughts, you know, as you talk about Burlington has a higher commercial rate, you know, why do we have a hard time then attracting, like, these businesses? How does a curate move here to Burlington to a higher tax rate?
I actually talked to the guy that stole them yesterday. He interviewed for a job. That was his mistake. Aggressive marketing. There are towns like Burlington that have staff, or they've hired consultants that do things like that.
They also have the space.
Absolutely.
Yeah. We have some.
Yeah, that's a discussion.
They have space. They're already here. Cost them to move. I mean,
yeah. They wanted more space. We didn't have it.
There's also been a time.
We had lots of opportunity for them to grow in space earlier.
This is a discussion we have most often with Wilmington because they're a little more like us.
Yeah.
Wilmington's almost infinite space to grow. So does North Reading. North Reading doesn't have the infrastructure, water and sewer, but they have the real estate. We've done the best we can with what we have. We just like more empty land. That solves some of our problems too.
And you can have all the empty land in the world, but if your permitting process is very difficult and the time to market is too long, you're going to suffer versus communities that can do it faster and more efficiently.
Yeah, we've spent a lot of time with the EDSAT and with other things over the last 2 years looking at the planning process and making some changes so that wouldn't be a problem. You know, ask the business community the answer. When I ask them what CFOs typically say, and ours isn't here tonight, I see, is, hey, in public, I'm going to tell you it's property taxes, but no one ever cares what that is. No business is going to move here because of property tax.
They're going to look
They're going to look at the demographics and other factors, access to customers, basically, and they're either going to think they'll succeed or fail. But it's not the cost.
Which are retail?
All. Office, anything. You know, do you have good transportation infrastructure for workers?
Just continues to be a frustration when you lose a great business like that.
Yeah.
And they chose to pay higher.
Well, and I don't think this is the case in Burlington, but another thing that other towns do is lure them away with money. They give you a tax break for 10 years. Mm-hmm. I think that's a really bad idea. I think that's bad economics. But there is some of that. Again, I don't think that happened in Burlington. They needed more space Burlington gave.
There are other things we can do also. I know that there's a discussion to be had with the RMLD board about high-speed internet as an option. And be able to have kind of a very high-speed corridor and try to use that. But that's the kind of marketing tactic we might be able to use in our favor as well.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a question of, is the town willing to dedicate resources to acquire businesses? We can barely have the resources to run the town. You know, that's a shot in the dark. That's a hope. We hope this works. If we do it better than others, it'll work. Believe me, our planning department has asked for years for another planner, just to be someone who is basically looking at economic development only. Nothing to do with existing homes, existing businesses, just outside the town. How do we get people in there? And one staff person alone isn't going to solve that problem.
And then we lost a key one, and we haven't replaced that person yet.
Yeah.
But that's part of why you have such good regeneration. We're underspent by 20 positions right now.
Yeah, at Town Hall last 20%. Year, the vacancy rate was about, on a dollar-weighted basis, was about 20%, so we can't retain people anymore. So that's not helping. That's why the free cash is higher. That's not a good reason for free cash to be higher. So, you know, all the optics, I'm not one to be thrilled about taxes and paying more taxes, but all the optics are that, you know, the residents in this town need to make the decision what level of services will we be satisfied with and what will we pay for? Because it's pretty clear that what they're asking for is not affordable with what they're paying. I guess that's really the bottom line.
Any questions or comments? I think that's a good segue, Dan, to the next topic.
Okay. My topic?
Your
topic. Yes, and this has been reported in the Advocate now, so I guess it's official. As you remember, my State of the Town address, I think we both gave a pretty strong message that it's time to start looking at the future and what we can do to sustain long-term revenues in a way that respects the tax-paying abilities of those in need. And I can repeat some of the stats that were gathered in that interactive survey.
I think you should.
Yeah, let me go over some of the key ones here. I think when the question was asked, should there be an override at some point in the future? Yes, 66%, no, 34%. And then would you like to see less services, the degree of services, less, 9%, same amount, 54%, more services, 26, I don't know, 10. So clearly almost two-thirds want the same or more. Actually, it's more than that. It's close to 90 for that. Then we asked the question on how much of an override in terms of a percent of the tax on the average residents. None, 19%. 2.5% or $160, 24%. 5% or $325 additional tax per year, 35% of that. Plus 7.5% or $490 a year, 15%. And plus 10% or $650 a year, 5%. More than that, only one. So there's a definite sweet spot at the 5%, which might be somewhat lower than we would like to see, but that's what the response was. To that end, we've begun to ask the question. We're going to continue that exercise with you folks in the school committee. In terms of sheer logistics, and certainly in terms of our free cash position, it doesn't seem to be logistically possible to do anything for FY17 right now. As you probably have heard, we're combining the town election with the presidential primary on March 1st. So all the preparation for that would have to be done almost immediately if there were any kind of a ballot question were going on. So that would have to be sometime at the earliest FY18. That gives us some time to work together. So this is just the beginning of the trail, but we're on the trail together. And we'll find out the best way and the best time and the amount to ask the question about. Any questions I can answer?
If I can make one comment, I think sure. That it was great to kind of get a little feeling from town meeting in terms of what's going on and letting them kind of play a little bit with numbers. The flip side of that is understanding really what services that means get delivered or don't get delivered. And town meeting didn't really have the benefit of understanding that right. Based on those numbers. And I think that's something we need to bring forward to people so they have a better feel for what that is, rather than just the number itself. Mm-hmm.
I think that we can use this year as an opportunity to kind of gauge the community about not only what you know what services that you know they really want to do can't do without, things that they want to add, getting a sense of you know where that sweet spot is, you know, giving people kind of choices, and then you know as these discussions go through either other financial forums or you know budget process throughout the year. You know, we have time to kind of figure out what is it, how much is it going to be for, and how much is it going to be, and what are we going to use it for? You know, Melrose is doing it right now, and they have a, that's been going on for a while, and they have a really strong group of, you know, community people kind of coalesced, and, you know, it wasn't sort of coming from the top down, it was sort of a community kind of thing, and, you know, looking at it as an FY18 kind of thing, I think we just give the community the opportunity to kind of weigh in and really almost tell us what they want. And I think that that's going to be an important piece, not just saying, oh, it's going to be 10%, it's going to be over this amount of time, and we're going to use it for this. I think we really need to you know, listen, go to the listening post and really hear, and for us to kind of lead that conversation.
And we do have an important decision to make next week regarding tax classification, the split between residents and commercial, industrial, personal. I don't know, this might be a case of Nixon going to China, but this board may be about to, and I'll speak for myself here, spoken to one other member of the board about this, but not to the quorum, so we haven't deliberated it, but I think it's time to reconsider that. And as a strategy for getting where we want to be.
I think what we hope to do at some of the financial forums is to start getting people to discuss what the options are and put, you know, put everything on the table that's possible. explore it, see what makes sense and what doesn't. Figure out, again, what we need, what we don't. But I think Barry's spot on. We need to hear kind of where the priorities are for services. You know, one of the things Bob talked about two meetings ago, maybe it was three, sorry, was the changing demographics of the population in Reading, both current and expected. And that's got a big impact on elder services and then even not quite elder services that are going to be required. We need to make sure as a constituency that we speak to all of them.
And that's not necessarily the exclusion of public-private partnerships and areas like that. In fact, that's a ripe one for public-private. Yeah. So all that has to be in the mix. Let's look at ways of lowering costs where we can, you know, through that means. And where you can't, you have to fund it.
From a practical standpoint, what I'm going to say, I'm sure it doesn't really work, but in the ideal world, I would really like not to have to show two budgets to the town to make them choose, because the two budgets are going to include layoffs of existing employees. And from a morale standpoint, that's awful. So I don't know how else you do that to really give people the honest truth. But to some degree, I would actually like to speak more in generalities, just for that reason. So we don't say, we're not going to do this function anymore, and we're only going to have one of these two things. So I just do want to point that out, and John can, you know, give his opinion, but we do have an organization to continue to run, and morale is an important part of that.
So rather than sort of saying,
did you want to respond, John?
It's a little bit more difficult with schools, because when you say you're cutting X program, everyone's going to know automatically who is in that program. So, I mean, you could say higher class sizes, but then they'll say where, and then, you know, that's, it, again, that's going to affect a certain population, so it'll be a little bit trickier.
But with 3.25%, you're talking
now. I can't answer that question yet.
Okay, I don't think so. That would have been, okay.
On the town side.
Okay.
I'm concerned on the school side, because we pulled every string that we could last year to get to the budget we were. And, you know, if revenue stayed the same for this year and costs stayed the same, factoring in, you know, contractual increases and special ed increased costs, we were looking at cuts. So we haven't done the numbers yet. We're in the process of doing that. I don't know yet.
Rather than doing sort of two budgets, you know, one that says, well, if we don't do it, this is what it's going to look like, I'd rather us see kind of do a budget of the things that we already know we need, people have talked about. I mean, John, you and your group just went through a whole series of months of meeting with parents in the schools about what's working, what's not working. You must have a whole kind of thing
been presenting
of what people are kind of like, hey, I wish we had this, or we want that back. I mean, so you've got a whole list of data. We on the town side, I mean, you know, should we have another planner in there? We just talked about how we can't recruit businesses. Well, that makes sense. I mean, you're looking at the planning department right here. I mean, how much is that? I mean, how realistic is that? So I almost would rather us do... This is the budget that's really going to take us to run the town over the next, you know, number of years.
Yeah.
And obviously that number is going to be higher than what we're doing now. And then people can kind of negotiate off of that and then say, okay, well, this is how we're going to fill it. And this is what, you know, people have already said. So doing two budgets, one is sort of what we have now, and then the one that, not a, you know, gold-plated budget, but the budget that we really think it's going to cost to run the town. I think that delta is how we have to figure out how to get filled. So that's not, you know, a bad exercise.
Yeah, to again, to use round numbers, very round, there's $1 million structural deficit every year, and there's $2 million we've indicated that are pretty easy to see that we should have. So the $2 million can do what you say. The $1 million is existing staff.
Right.
So if we can just categorize and say, well, we'll have to lose $1 million costs, oh, that'd be fine, and really focus on the other. I just want to be careful and just let that message get out there that I really would not want to have to identify specific people if we don't have to. Most of the time, you do. That's what it comes down to in most communities. It'd be nice to try it in Reading the first time without doing that. I don't know if that'll work. Yeah.
I just
want
to go back to something. I think the importance of protecting employee morale. morale is a good thing to bring up. It's also a hard thing to quantify that is being impacted right now. When you talk about positions going unfilled, what does that do to morale when somebody leaves? And you know why they left, and you can't fill the position. So I think, in general, employee morale, I certainly feel on the school side, is something that you can't put in a grid, you can't put in a chart, but we need to be cognizant of it. So I think it was a very good point.
Yeah, and that's a real tough marketing point. That's not what the taxpayer wants to hear. That's tough to, you're right, it's tough to quantify.
I'm just a little unclear about, I don't see how we can avoid doing up two budgets. It seems like we need to see a budget with the guideline that we set forth, which I find
not that budget. There's a budget that would go to town meeting with all the detail, and then there's something much more summarized. I agree, it's two budgets.
I was looking through the FinCom, let's say FinCom manual, and in towns that have open town meetings without having the election, like just before town meeting, FinComs do present all the budgets where there's an override going to the voters. It has been done. There are pros and cons, as Bob has pointed out.
Yeah, and I will say, compared to most of the town meeting warrants that I've read, few are like us, but Reading is highly detailed in the information. Many towns just say department, and that's kind of a broad term, wages, expenses. It doesn't tell you anything. It could be 8 employees, it could be 4. You don't really know. It doesn't say how many FTEs. So that's another way to sort of disguise, if you will, things, although it become pretty obvious. But, I don't like that. I like being as transparent as we are, because people can look at it and know exactly what's going on. But that makes this issue a little harder.
Comments or questions?
I'm venturing into an area I'm not quite as comfortable with, but when I was hearing Barry talk about the free cash, and I was hearing Bob talk also about best practices and not lowering our free cash, and I'm thinking about the needs that I just heard going to the CPAC, the Special Needs Parent Advisory Committee, and going to the forums from the school side. And if we're going to look at what we did last year with a lower budget number, the danger is that we're not going to be, I guess the question is, are we going to be willing to look at that free cash as part of the negotiations, so that we're going to, when we're doing the budget, are we going to look at what we need to take from the free cash to make the town side and the school side and the other expenses meet the needs of the town? And that's part of the reality the town's going to have to see. Like, if we try to dress it up, we can do this $1 million or we can do it $2 million, and they choose the $1 million, then we are going to be hurting and not delivering some of the basic services, whether it's in the school side, whether it's special ed, or whether it's regular ed, or whatever. Are we going to venture into that free cash? Because we need to.
If we were going to run the town on a going out of business basis, we could have another 2 really good years and then not worry. some towns actually do that.
Must sell to the walls.
If there's a key mayor retirement, some places do that. But, FinCom could be asked for more free cash for next year. And, we could have satisfactory budgets. And then in FY18, do the same thing. And then we're pretty much out of cash. But we could have 2 good years, and the residents would be happy, the employees would be happy. Anyone looking beyond the 2 years shouldn't be happy, but you could. And that's the tough message, which kind of was one of Barry's points, is how can you tell people, how can you look at them with a straight face when you got a big bank account? Well, the point is, you're supposed to have something in the bank. Maybe it's not 10% like we have, maybe it's 8%. Okay, there's another $1 million in there. But there's other one-time things lurking out there. That some of us know about, whether it's litigation or whether it's construction.
Snow and ice.
You got to have free cash for reasons. you know, we have a DPW garage that is in desperate need of fixing. Now, FinCom's policy is anything more than a million or two goes to the voters as a debt exclusion. Well, good luck to us asking the voters for $20 million for a new DPW garage, because I don't think that's happening. Although it happened in one community.
Plus it's tied to some bigger economic picture.
But, you know, with an override discussion, we could say, we're not going to come to you for any other buildings for another 10 years. We'll take care of everything inside the levy, such as things you probably wouldn't support that we really need. You know, whether it's a cemetery garage, or DPW garage, or whatever it is that we need. So it certainly has to be a very comprehensive discussion financially. And, you know, you'll find out, if you communicate reasonably well, you'll find out easily what kind of town you live in. I tend to think that taxpayers, just like town meeting members, once they're informed, they'll get it. You know, they'll make an informed decision. I think most people want the services that they say they want. And for another $300-$600 a year, you know, they'll decide how much they want it. But, you know, you could be more financially risky and not ask for another year. I think that'd be a big mistake. I mean, when I say another year, I mean FY19.
Yeah.
I think you have to be honest with them and ask now and see what they say. And then you readjust, you know, your plan if they say no. And historically, the first override gets in the time, much of the time. And there's other communities that ask every year. The communities on the top of this list didn't get there because they never ask. You know, there's debt exclusions and capital exclusions and overrides almost every year in some of those communities. I shouldn't say which one, but one of them I'm working with because they're looking to change their form of government to actually be town manager, which is interesting. And I said to them, this committee that's working, I said, well, you'll become much more financially effective and efficient if you change to a more centralized form of government, whatever you want to call it, because there won't be all these elected boards and committees going out doing their own thing and not doing it together. And the answer I got was, oh, we don't care how much it costs to run the town. We just ask taxpayers for more. So that's not an issue. It's like, oh, my God. So there are towns that people, you know, equate Reading to that are run very differently than Reading. And there is sort of an infinite capacity to ask the taxpayer in some of those. We haven't asked them so long, the town is very different than it was 13 years ago. Maybe we live in a community that's more like that and we don't realize it. You know, we need to find out.
Well, we've asked them just for capital.
Yeah, we have.
You mean from an operating standpoint? Or?
Yes. I mean, beyond the modulars that have already been installed, are there additional costs that aren't included in the particular budget, but the school budget, that are of concern?
Well, I see. I still don't think I understand your question. Are you talking about with the current kindergarten class?
Yes. My understanding was that there was something like 75 full-time students that was unexpected. And so now that the modulars are in place, are there additional operating budget or costs associated with having these extra students that maybe have been accounted for as part of the budget?
It's difficult to predict because you don't know what the next kindergarten class is going to look like. And so it's all based on the amount of teachers that you need for your elementary schools. So in some schools next year for first grade, we will need more teachers. It depends what we have leaving fifth grade. And coming in at kindergarten that determines, are we at, you know, net? Do we have to add teachers, subtract teachers, or are we the same?
So the single year flood doesn't have a significant impact unless next year's class
Correct.
Is also large.
Correct.
Oh, so this year's kindergarten in terms of just number of students, not full day or half day, but number of students was a lot bigger than expected?
We had more students in full day.
Yeah, so.
And we also had more, we had more students in general. On average, and yeah, and they were concentrated mainly in two schools, Kilman and Barrows.
But in totality, a big flip or not?
It's higher than what our average number is.
And it's sort of, now that we have the space, it's sort of irrelevant operating and cost wise, but it's not there for this, and we're covering that extra cost for the full days. Because they're paying.
Yeah, my concern is the number of teachers you now need moving forward.
Exactly, that's what
I'm saying. And it all depends on what is exiting at the end of elementary and what's coming in each year. And we won't know till the beginning of January what, you know, ballpark our kindergarten enrollment would be for this year.
Other great ideas for enhancing revenue. Good. All right. I think what we'll do then is why don't we move into a discussion on Article 35?
Sure. If I could also just ask, since income is $2 million a reasonable number for John and I to work with?
I have a couple of questions related to that. First one, healthcare costs. At 8%. What's a percent worth?
$1 million.
$1 million is per percent. So if it comes in at 12 rather than 8, that's a $4 million issue?
That's split across RMLD, water, sewer, and the general fund. So the general fund might be $600,000 or $700,000.
Oh, okay. So I'm sorry, from 8 to, so it's $600,000 or $700,000 per percent?
Yeah.
Okay, so if it goes from 8 to 12, we're looking at this. Okay. Yeah. Wow. Okay, so what do people think about that?
I like the way you approached it last year, giving to me 8% very reasonable. Mm-hmm. And that's what we have free cash for, is when things go out, but it's reasonable. I like the attitude of doing an assumption that's in the realm. We're talking 8% in the realm. We should be going, oh, 8% is a lot. And then we have free cash to cover any big surprises. I think that's appropriate.
How about state aid?
I don't have a real sense of that in terms of trend. See, $14 million. So a percent is what? $140,000.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be as volatile as health insurance, for sure.
Right.
But if it goes to zero, what's that, $300,000 to $400,000?
The only, since Chapter 70 is a big chunk of the state aid, my only caution on state aid is that we've reached our foundation limit. We usually, and what is historically the last few years at the state level, is that you're held harmless and you get $25 a student. So Chapter 70 will not go up significantly. Whereas a few years ago, it was going up, but now we've reached our foundation limit. So it's something to keep in mind. My guess is the state is not going to increase Chapter 70 significantly, knowing that the foundation committee is still working on recommendations, which probably won't come in effect for 17.
But perhaps for 18. Things move really fast.
They've got to find the revenue to do that also.
So you're comfortable with the same sort of arrangement on that as we've had?
I want to get a little bit more input from others on other thoughts. Let me just pass one quick point. I think that if we say 2, we really need to be comfortable that it's more like 3. And if we're comfortable with that kind of a number coming out, that's the right guidance, because between health insurance and state aid and whatever else, there could be a blip. I do remember, however, last year that our health insurance consultants told us, jumped up and down, that no way would it be 8.5, and sure enough, it was.
It's going to be 14.
It was 8.2.
They were
the same 14.
And they were predicting the sky was going to fall.
Bid was.
Yeah, no, I understand.
Yeah, and I just want to clarify, I'm not sure what you asked, I'm not sure I answered the right question. 1% of health insurance is about $150,000. I might have answered it differently.
Oh,
yeah.
I did break it a little
quite a bit more.
No, I was thinking of a different question.
Okay. Okay.
So, yeah, because, I mean, it'd be unbelievable if it was three times the cash.
That makes me feel much more comfortable with you, Nora.
Yeah, I'm starting to get it.
What's the census ask me? Is that a reasonable number? I think we're doing.
I thought he was asking what is 1%.
Yeah.
I didn't know what he was asking.
All right, so can we say, so that 2 million is a good range to work.
And those other pieces, state aid and health insurance, generally okay. So you might be looking at 2.5 million.
I think that's what we're talking about, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's very reasonable in the circumstances. And Sharon, thank you for increasing to 1.5. I think those are good ranges to work with, and hopefully our experience in health continues to be good, and that the state comes through.
Well, society can't afford 20% health insurance increases every year, so somehow, someday, it's going to change.
Absolutely.
Don't ask me.
And if we start making that the assumption, we start accepting.
So are you putting in the budget an assumption of like 8?
I'm putting 8 from now on.
8 and then?
8 forever.
And then if it goes to 8. And then if it's higher, it's going to be higher.
I think our actuaries use 8 and then they decline it to 6 or 5 over some period of time. Right?
Oh, for do you think? I thought it was 8. Oh, you're right. It is
8 in the current year. But then they decline.
I didn't notice that they declined.
Yeah.
I think the other issues for us that we're going to want to be dealing with over the course of the next several meetings is, number one, do we want to recommend a higher reserve than the 5% number, and if so, what that number should be. So that's something I think we're going to want to tackle.
That actually lends itself to a conversation we're going to bring forward on the next one, which is our auditors had asked us to put in place a fund balance policy. Was to address the GASB 54, which breaks down our fund balance into different categories, but also to identify a minimum fund balance that we'd like to state. And we kind of have that in place with FinCom at the 5%, but they wanted the Board of Selectmen to agree to put a policy on paper that they could see related to the Board of Selectmen. And so the Board of Selectmen did see that drafted policy that I put together, but we wanted to bring it forward to FinCom to look at, because I was saying somewhere in that 5 to 7, maybe you guys have a higher number in mind, but if we're going to put that policy on paper for the auditors to have for their record of the way we look at it and what we consider to be the minimum that we would want in fund balance, which is really up to cash and stabilization and such. So that's definitely something that I was going to bring to you at the next meeting anyway, so it's good timing for that to come up. So we'll talk about that. I do have it all drafted in. Can be modified. It's all in draft form, but from whatever you and the Board of Selectmen decide, I can modify the policy.
And then we have my favorite topic of OPEB contributions to think about as well.
Oh yeah, we have never put a policy in place.
My personal opinion is that we should be careful about how high we raise that suggested number to, because. Mm-hmm. If we are kind of saying it's free, but it's not, we kind of defeated its purpose. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We want to be pretty careful about that.
So that's the discussion then. So we have, what is that number? Is it 5? Is it 6? Is it 7? Is it 8? I think that we're closer to 10 right currently.
Yeah, we are. We're kind of.
Yeah, so that's definitely a conversation of the comfort level we have with whatever the number is that's selected. So.
Just to put another dollar figure out there that's scary, we need another $1.5 million a year to fund OPEB. In the general fund every year. If we were fully funding OPEB like we are our pension, we'd be throwing another $1.5 million in the general fund every year.
But it's not mandated.
No, it's not required. It's not mandated. Someday one assumes it will. Some communities. And 2 million is roughly our annual.
25%
of it.
Pretty much putting a quarter of it. Yeah. Although the enterprise is not fully funded.
Yeah. And our
which is the smaller
but
piece,
that's another aspect. Some communities have done an override and put OPEB right in there.
Yeah.
But other communities are not contributing as we are.
Other communities aren't doing anything with it. Some of them are doing nothing and just being very aggressive in funding their pension and hoping to redirect those funds to OPEB. But that's a lot of years down the road for us. I mean, I think 2029 is where our valuation is coming out that will be fully funded for pensions. It's a lot. 11 years too late to ready to start funding.
Maybe it'll go. Other topics? All right, so FinCom, I think we're going to move to discussion on Articles 3 and 5. Based on what the from the building committee came back and asked.
You want me to ask him about
Chairman, is after the discussion, would you mind if our board voted first? And then you guys? Okay. Yep, we'll listen to the discussion first.
Article 3 on page 16. From what all you boards voted previously, there's an addition of $200,000 into the facilities department for design study and construction documents for the cemetery facility. And again, you can see the draft minutes. And then also there's a deletion of the $2 million cemetery garage as debt, shown in the middle of page 16. So we've referred back to $1.5 million in FY18. So those would be the two changes in Article 3.
That are on the table. Is this a motion? Yes. We have a motion to approve Article 3 as amended in tonight's material.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? Vote carries 3-0. Thank you.
Yeah, actually, I have one question on really my understanding of I'll say loosely the request, the $200,000, and what that design study covers. Like, it's not being as familiar or in that industry. Kind of, where does that study start and where does it end? Just help me understand kind of the scope of what would be done.
Yeah, I can do that. First of all, it's a little hard for me to keep up with them because they're all experts in the committee. But from what I've gathered. A couple of them went out and canvassed the market and got some numbers, and it ranged from $136,000 to $150,000 to do what they thought they should do at this stage. To backtrack, the Permanent Building Committee has received all documents to date that have been done on the cemetery garage and on the DPW garage. So there has been past studies. They've read through them all. They've asked a lot of questions. They understand them pretty well. They're actually... believe it or not, they're going on a tour of all the cemeteries on Halloween, costume costumes. I think it's 11 a.m. at Town Hall. I'm not going with them. I'm going to have a roll call when they finish.
See how many come back.
Yeah, exactly. So they're really hitting the ground and taking this pretty seriously. And they intend, I think the message that came through very clearly, I know Barry and I have talked about this from town meeting, is if you're going to ask us for a building, please come to us with a fully vetted proposal. And so the $150,000 should give town meeting a very fully vetted proposal, looking at options, looking at land, at location, and looking at options. I actually suggested $50,000 more, partly because you don't know, but that would also let them do test bores for ledge, for instance. That's not something they had thought about, if some of the locations, especially the current location, is needed to be tested. So
for what? I'm sorry.
For ledge.
For ledge.
$200,000 is very likely to be more than they need to do this work. But it would pretty much get you right up to RFP status. So that there would be a package ready to put out to bid with town meeting's approval. So it would be a package that would come to town meeting, if you will, in a more advanced form than town meeting is typically seen.
Would this study, I guess, look at both possibilities of a combined with DPW, or this is solely a standalone?
To be determined. I'd say it's leaning towards solely, but there's still a discussion to be had. And just to be clear, when I say design, I don't mean architectural work.
Correct.
I mean ready to go out to bid to an architect who will then actually design the thing fully.
So we call that, what, 25% design or something like that?
I think so.
That's my only hesitation, right, is if we're spending that piece of money going down the direction of a standalone building, but we still haven't answered the question of is a standalone building the right answer versus a combined building? It's not a hesitation over the process and spending the money. I fully agree that it sounds like we have an amazing group with a lot of experience in place, so I trust that. I get a little trapped on the fundamental question of where are we going with the building itself.
Well, I think the committee is open-minded, and I've sat in on two of their meetings. One of the gentlemen on the committee has actually built three DPWs. None of them co-locate the cemetery garage. And I think there's probably only two in the area that do that. So it's very much the exception, apparently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also they're aware of all the possibilities. We've met in executive session. They're not going to be hasty in spending anything unless they're sure that's the path they want to go down. So this isn't something that, if approved in November, is going to be spent the next day without a lot more discussion.
This is just authorizing.
It's just authorizing the money because they know to do this work, you're talking about preparing for a year from now at annual town meeting, probably. Mm-hmm. Realistically. It's in for FY18.
He's the guy in charge of the money.
Yeah, they can't spend it. Yeah.
And to be clear, this is really the process that we envisioned, that projects like this would go to the Permanent Building Committee, they would request funding to do a study, and then based on everything coming back, then it could come to town meeting, and then if need be, the vote as well. So.
And it could be they come back after doing a certain amount of work and say, you know, we need another $200,000 or whatever it is to look at the DPW site. But I'm sure they won't spend $200,000 before they get to that question.
Moment in the capital plan for the cemetery?
We have $1.5 million as debt starting in FY18 for both the cemetery garage and improvements to the DPW yard, so $3 million total. That's currently in the capital plan.
I'm sorry, what year was that?
FY18.
Right. This adds the 200K of the plan for FY16.
I should know where we ended.
Please. motion to accept the amended article, or do we reference just the incremental 200,000?
Probably it's not an amended article. This is the article. This
right.
is the
yeah.
new article.
As presented.
So, as presented.
Motion to approve the article as presented.
Easy.
Second. Okay. Any discussion? Okay. No? All those in favor? Opposed? We are 6.
$50. So $40,000.
She's got Article 4.
Article 4 needs to go up by $50. Okay. You can imagine that.
Their motion is
just going to be $50. And so just
I legally cannot pay the bill.
Motion to approve Article 4.
Second. All in favor of revised Article 4. There you go. Carries. Thank you.
Motion to accept Article 4 as amended.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? We are 5-0. Article 5.
Okay, Article 5 adds the $200,000 under C99. And then if you go to page 20, it reduces the amount of free cash necessary to do that. So you're just also approving, if you will, sources of funds.
And that's based on the 212.
Yeah, that's based on that extra new growth.
So the motion to approve Article 5 as amended in tonight's material.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, discussion? All in favor? The vote carries 3-0.
Impact and a motion under Article 5 as amended.
Motion to accept the article as amended.
Second. Discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? 6-0.
Thank you. Now FinCom has minutes at the very end, if you would.
All right.
everyone else probably doesn't have to hang around for this, although it can be exciting.
Thank you, everybody, for attending.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn. Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
So, Dan.